Simon & Schuster Audio presents White Ivy, a novel by Susie Yang, read by Emily Wu Zeller.
For Alex, in every life. The snow goose need not bathe to make itself white. Chinese proverb. Part 1. 1. Ivy Lynn was a thief, but you would never know it to look at her. Maybe that was the problem. No one ever suspected, and that made her reckless. Her features were so average and nondescript that the brain only needed a split second to develop a complete understanding of her. Skinny Asian girl, quiet, overly docile around adults in uniforms. She had a way of walking, shoulders forward, chin tucked under, arms barely swinging, that rendered her invisible in the way of pigeons and janitors. Ivy would have traded her face 1,000 times over for a blue-eyed, blonde-haired version like the Satterfield twins, or even a red-headed, freckly version like Liza Johnson, instead of her own Chinese one with its too thin lips, embarrassingly high forehead, two fleshy cheeks like ripe apples before the autumn pickings. Because of those cheeks, at 14 years old, she was often mistaken for an elementary school student. An unfortunate hindrance in everything except thieving, in which her childlike looks were a useful camouflage. Ivy's only source of vanity was her eyes. They were pleasingly round, symmetrically situated, cocoa brown in color, with crescent corners dipped in like the ends of a stuffed dumpling. Her grandmother had trimmed her lashes when she was a baby to stimulate growth, and it seemed to have worked. For now she was blessed with a flurry of thick, black lashes that other girls could only achieve with copious layers of mascara, and not even then. By any standard, she had nice eyes, but especially for a Chinese girl, and they saved her from an otherwise plain face. So how exactly had this unassuming, big-eyed girl come to thieving? In the same way water trickles into even the tiniest cracks between boulders, her personality had formed into crooked shapes around the hard structure of her Chinese upbringing. When Ivy was 2 years old, her parents immigrated to the United States and left her in the care of her maternal grandmother, Mei Feng, in their hometown of Chongqing. Of her next 3 years in China, she remembered very little, except one vivid memory of pressing her face into the scratchy fibers of her grandmother's coat, shouting, "You tricked me! You tricked me!" after she realized Mei Feng had abandoned her to the care of a neighbor to take an extra clerical shift. Even then, Ivy had none of the undiscerning friendliness of other children. Her love was passionate, but singular. Complete devotion, or none at all. When Ivy turned 5, Nan and Shen Lin had finally saved enough money to send for their daughter. "You'll go and live in a wonderful state in America," Mei Feng told her, "called Massachusetts." She'd seen the photographs her parents mailed home. Pastoral scenes of ponds, square lawns, blue skies, trees that only bloomed vibrant pink and fuchsia flowers, which her pale-cheeked mother, whom she could no longer remember, was always holding by thin branches that resembled the sticks of sugared plums Ivy ate on New Year's. All this caused much excitement for the journey. She adored taking trips with her grandmother. But at the last minute, after handing Ivy off to a smartly dressed flight attendant with fascinating gold buttons on her vest, Mei Feng disappeared into the airport crowd. Ivy threw up on the airplane and cried nearly the entire flight. Upon landing at Logan Airport, she howled as the flight attendant pushed her toward two Asian strangers waiting at the gate, with a screaming baby no larger than the daikon radishes she used to help Mei Feng pull out of their soil, crusty smears all over his clenched white fists. Ivy dragged her feet, tripped over a shoelace, and landed on her knees.
"Stand up now," said the man,
offering his hand. The woman continued to rock the baby. She addressed her husband in a weary tone. "Where are her suitcases?" Ivy wiped her face and took the man's hand. She had already intuited that tears would have no place with these brick-faced people. So different from the gregarious aunties in China who'd coax her with a fresh box of chalk or white rabbit taffies should she display the slightest sign of displeasure. This became Ivy's earliest memory of her family. Shen Lin's hard, calloused fingers over her own. His particular scent of tobacco and minty toothpaste. The clear winter light flitting in through the floor-to-ceiling windows, beyond which airplanes were taking off and landing. Her brother Austin, no more than a little sack and smelly diapers in Nan's arms. Walking among them, but not one of them, Ivy felt a queer, dissociative sensation. Not unlike being submerged in a bathtub, where everything felt both expansive and compressed. In years to come, whenever she felt like crying, she would invoke this feeling of being submerged, and the tears would dissipate across her eyes in a thin, glistening film, disappearing into the bathwater. Nan and Shen's child-rearing discipline was heavy on the corporal punishment, but light on the chores. This meant that while Ivy never had to make a bed, she did develop a high tolerance for pain. As with many immigrant parents, the only real wish Nan and Shen had for their daughter was that she become a doctor. All Ivy had to do was claim, "I want to be a doctor," to see her parents' faces light up with approval, which was akin to love, and just as scarce to come by. Mei Feng had been an affectionate, if brusque, caretaker. But Nan was not this way. The only times Ivy felt the warmth of her mother's arms were when company came over. Usually it was Nan's younger sister Ping and her husband, or one of Shen's Chinese co-workers at the small IT company he worked for. During those festive Saturday afternoons, munching on sunflower seeds and lychees, Nan's downturned mouth would right itself like a sail catching wind, and she would transform into a kinder, more relaxed mother, one without the little pinch between her brows. Ivy would wait all afternoon for this moment to scoot close to her mother on the sofa. Closer, closer. And then, with the barest of movements, she'd slide into Nan's lap. Sometimes Nan would put her hands around Ivy's waist. Other times she'd pet her head in an absent, fitful way, as if she wasn't aware of doing it. Ivy would try to stay as still as possible. It was a frightful, stolen pleasure, but how she craved the touch of a bosom, a fleshy lap to rest on. She'd always thought she was being exceedingly clever, that her mother hadn't a clue what was going on. But when she was 6 years old, she did the same maneuver, only this time, Nan's body stiffened. "Aren't you a little old for this now?" Ivy froze. The adults around her chuckled. "Look how Nia your daughter is," they exclaimed. Nia was Sichuan dialect for clingy. Ivy forced her eyes open as wide as they would go. It was no use. She could taste the salt on her lips. "Look at you," Nan chastised. "They're just teasing. I can't believe how thin-skinned you are. You're an older sister now. You should be braver. Now be good and tinghua. Go wipe your nose." To her dying day, Ivy would remember this feeling. Shame, confusion, hurt, defiance, and a terrible loneliness that turned her permanently inward. So that when Mei Feng later told her she had been a trusting and affectionate baby, she thought her grandmother was confusing her with Austin. Ivy became a secretive child, sharing her inner life with no one, except on occasion, Austin, whose approval, unlike everyone else's in the family, came unconditionally. Suffice it to say, neither of Ivy's parents provided any resources for her fanciful imagination. What kind of life would she have? What kind of love and excitement awaited her in her future? These finer details Ivy filled in with books. She learned English easily. Indeed, she could not remember a time she had not understood English, and became a precocious reader. The tiny, unkempt West Mapleberry Library, staffed by a half-deaf librarian, was Nan's version of free babysitting. It was Ivy's favorite place in the whole world. She was drawn to books with bleak circumstances. Orphans, star-crossed lovers, captives of lecherous uncles and evil stepmothers, the anorexic cheerleader.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.